Have you ever thought about doing something or using something, but later come to find out that you can't because of Apple? That's like me all the time. Like maybe that time you found out Apple has a Bluetooth audio sharing feature, and you thought about using it on a plane with someone else to watch a movie together, but you find out you can't use it because one of you doesn't have Apple headphones and it only works with Apple headphones. Or that time you were hanging out and you were gonna watch something on Apple TV Plus that you had heard about online, but you find out that you don't have a compatible device. So let me know if this makes sense. There's days where I feel like Apple is putting out things and doing things to make my life easier and better in some way, and other days where I just feel like a cash machine that only exists to make them money. To me, that kind of makes it bittersweet to use Apple products because, in a way, everything they put out is a double-edged sword. Most things they release have a drawback, but also have benefits that kind of make it hard to weigh whether or not it's worth diving into, purchasing, or subscribing to. Typically, these drawbacks don't deter you fully from the product or service, but they usually involve you spending more money. Let me start with a fresh example. This fall, Apple released their iPhone 12 lineup, and part of the presentation was a big display of environmental statistics of all these improvements they've made that reduce waste and reduce carbon footprint of the company and all these things that really do help the environment. This is great stuff. This is good. I'm not saying this is bad. And they go on to discuss how they can further that environmental impact that they're having by removing the charging brick from the box. They'll still provide you a new cable, USB-C to Lightning, but that's not compatible with the brick you already have. So when this happened, most people asked, "What if I don't have a compatible brick for this cable?" Oh, Apple will sell you one, don't worry. One of the most infuriating things about being an iPhone owner to me has been every year for years, they just ship the slow 5-watt charger in the box. Even as faster, better chargers become cheaper to make, cheaper to purchase, that's still what they sold in the box. And now that they've turned around and removed this from the box, other phone manufacturers have taken this as permission to stop providing chargers. Even though they've been providing fast chargers for free for years, now they'll provide nothing because Apple made it okay. A less important part of this that's still worth mentioning is that when they dropped the charging brick in the box, they also dropped the free wired headphones that plug into the Lightning port. And I just think it's convenient that they push people to Bluetooth like that when they happen to sell multiple Bluetooth audio devices that you can purchase from them as well. Now, like I said before, it's not like they're totally lying about this environmental impact. This stuff is a big deal. And at their scale, small changes like that do add up. One statistic that jumps out to me is that these changes that they made are the equivalent, according to them, of removing 450,000 cars from the road every year, which is crazy. So I really do find myself torn between this positive environmental impact they're having on the planet and the fact that people might have to buy a charger when they get their new phone. Another time I experienced this kind of split between does Apple want to help me or hurt me and take my money or that sort of thing is recently with Apple Fitness Plus. So if you don't know, it's Apple's paid subscription service, one of their many subscription services now, where you can participate in video workouts that are recorded from their studio, and then they hook up to your watch, they display your stats on the screen, and they have trainers in the videos to keep you motivated as it goes along. Now this year, being at home more, I've tried to stay more active than I have been in years past, and my Apple Watch and the fitness app and all the statistics and stuff that I can track over time, that has really helped me stay active. Now the second you pick up the paid offering, Apple Fitness Plus, there's benefits and immediate drawbacks. Now the biggest limitation to me is the device playback choices. You can watch it on your iPhone, your iPad, or your Apple TV. That's it. You need the watch to track your stats, and it shows them on the screen. But you need one of those three devices to display it. So no Chromecast, no PlayStation, no Roku, Fire TV, none of that, at least as of right now. But to me, that's a big deal. Personally, we've been using this on iPads, but it gets kind of small when you're moving around and you're not that close to it. It can be kind of hard to see and replicate the moves. So I'm kind of drawn towards maybe I need to buy an Apple TV. But it feels like they knew I would reach that conclusion. Being in a pandemic, people are isolated, but a lot of people are isolated with someone in their home. And one obvious thing to me would be to have a group workout option. Apple Fitness Plus also does not have that. So if multiple people want to do it, you can share the subscription with Apple Family Sharing, but you can't do workouts together and show your stats together on the screen at once. Now, even with my complaints, it always comes back to the positives. And with Fitness Plus, I'm still in the free trial, but I find it to be worth the money if I were paying for it. The trainers in the videos are really good, really motivational. It's almost like having a gym membership, but you get to stay home. It's a lot cheaper. And the workouts are well planned. It's better than anything I would pull off the internet and do on my own. It's just a lot better. One more quick example of this back and forth is the Apple Card. So aside from getting the shiny metal card, the app gives you interest calculations that other cards don't give you. They offer you instant cash back that you can redeem day to day. They've got spending tracking tools in the app to help you spend more responsibly. And most importantly, they offer 0% financing on Apple products and devices. Now, I mentioned that last one because that's where the trade-off comes in. all these features I feel like are beneficial to people that have the card, but that last one cuts both ways. Since this is a credit card, Apple's probably making some kind of money on every purchase you make anyway. But if they're also able to convince you to buy more Apple products using their card because they can offer you 0% financing, you might be spending more than you would have otherwise, and I'm not really sure who wins in that situation, if it's you or Apple. So honestly, I'm still as confused when I started writing this video as to how I feel, but I think the safest way to frame this, for me at least, is everything they do that might harm people or make them spend more money or whatever you want to say, they do other things, or there's things embedded in those money grabs that are beneficial to people that buy their products. Just last year, they released 3 new Macs that all have the new Apple proprietary processor, the M1. And by doing that, they were able to drastically increase battery life and make things process actually faster than a lot of the Intel models that they sold before. There wasn't really any price hike or anything funky going on like that. So to me, something like that is a net benefit for consumers. There's not really anything underhanded with that. So I'm honestly really interested to see if I'm the only person that thinks this way. This could all just be in my head. If there's anything I touched on in this video that might be interesting to dive deeper on in another video or in the comments or on Twitter, whatever, just let me know. Don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. Hopefully I'll be back with another video soon. I'll see you guys later.